In this session, we'll see how to install Nextcloud with Docker script. What is Nextcloud? Nextcloud is a self-hosted productivity platform that keeps you in control. Actually, it is like Google Drive, but also has a calendar and other useful applications that help you to share and collaborate on documents, send and receive email, manage your calendar, and so on. So it is like a collaboration suite, but it can be installed on your own server, different from other solutions like Gmail, etc. Now, Nextcloud can be installed on a Linux machine like Ubuntu or something else. It can be installed using Docker, but in this session we will install it with Docker scripts. Now, let's explain a little bit what are Docker scripts. Docker scripts are a bunch of scripts or a system of scripts that help to manage Docker containers. Let's try to make a diagram to explain this. Suppose that this is our VPS. I'm not so good at drawing. And in this VPS, we want to host different applications. For example, we want to host Nextcloud. We want to host also ET, which is a web interface for Git, and also want to host some other application, for example, WordPress. The problem in this case is that all of these applications use the port 80 and 443. And so the host only has one port, 443. So where should it forward the request that comes? This is kind of a problem. To help with this, we use another application which acts like a proxy. This proxy knows by the domain name where each application is located and can forward properly the request. If the request is for Git, it can send it here. If the request is for WordPress, it can send it here. And if the request is for Nextcloud, then it will send it to the proper container. The way that it works is by virtual Apache domain, by Apache virtual domains. This proxy application is encapsulated by Docker script in a Docker container, and also Nextcloud, WordPress, Git, etc. are encapsulated in different containers. Each one of them has a container, and these containers are connected to a local network. This is a virtual local network, is an internal local network, which is managed by Docker and Docker scripts. And this is how the proxy communicates with these containers, or with these applications. Now, some of these applications also need to use a database. For example, Nextcloud can be installed standalone, but it is better to install it with an external database. WordPress as well can use an external database. So for the database, there is another container that should be installed. DockerScript used MariaDB for that database. And so these applications through this internal network can connect to the database and store and retrieve data from it. So in order to install Nextcloud with Docker scripts, we need to install also a proxy container and also MariaDB container. And then, of course, the Nextcloud container. But first of all, if the host is a new one, has nothing installed on it, we, of course, have to install Docker first. Let's clear this. So the first thing we need to install is Docker itself. Next, we will need to install the proxy container, which is, by the way, it is called WS proxy in web server proxy in Docker scripts. Then we also need to install a MariaDB container because Nextcloud will be connected to an external database. And then finally, we will install Nextcloud container itself. Let's clear again. These steps are roughly described in this blog post that I have written, installing Nextcloud. And here we have steps for installing Docker, install Docker scripts. Okay, we forgot that we also need to install Docker scripts. And then web server proxy. And we will install a database before installing Nextcloud. Nextcloud can be installed without a database as well, but we will install a database before installing Nextcloud. There is also a Katakoda lesson or interactive tutorial for installing Nextcloud in this location, katakoda.com/courses. If you go to Dashamir, then you can go to Docker scripts and then find Nextcloud. So first of all, installing Docker. The most easy way is to install Docker is with this one line command: get the script, get docker.ssh, and then run it, and it will install Docker. We are here on the server of Flask. Actually, the Docker is installed, but we can try it again. It doesn't hurt. Get this script by curl. And then run it. Okay, that acts already. The Docker is already installed, but this is how we install Docker. Then install Docker scripts. In order to install Docker scripts, we first have to install these packages, mfar, git, and also make. We need the make command. So we run install mfar git make. All of them are already installed. Then we should clone these this repo from GitLab and store it or place it to this location. It is already done. Let's check it. Then to install it, we write make install to install Docker scripts. Let's refresh it. Okay, there are some changes. Then make install. It installs the latest version. And this is done, installing Docker scripts. Now, the next step is to install the proxy, which is called WS proxy in Docker scripts. The way that we install Docker script applications is kind of similar for one application with another one, or for one container with another one. There are certain kind of standard steps. First, we get the Docker scripts, and we get them with DS pool and the name of the application. In this case, DS pool to proxy. DS pool WS proxy. What DS pool does, it does clones these GitLab repository to the directory of Docker scripts. So it gets the scripts from GitLab. And after we get scripts, then we can initialize the application. This is the second step. Docker script init. This is the name of the application, WS proxy, and this is the location where this application or this Docker container will be installed. This at sign is the placed before the name of the directory, and this directory is in the location var ds. So if we say when we write at sign WS proxy for Docker scripts, this means the directory var ds and then WS proxy. This is already initialized this WS proxy container. Let's go to this directory and check the settings, and then with the command make, we can install it or reinstall. Usually we check the settings before building the container. There are certain things that may need to change. For example, SMTP server, SMTP domain, these are used for sending notifications. But are not so important. Usually these are commented and we can leave them empty. And then run BS make to build the container. In this case, it is rebuilding the container, but for this application, for WS proxy, rebuilding a container doesn't make any change. It just updates the application, if possible, the Docker container, and it reuses the data that the previous application already had, data and configurations. So we already built this container, WS proxy, and we are done with this. Let's go to the next step. The next step is to install the database. Again, for installing the database, we follow these four or five steps. Get the scripts from the GitLab. Initialize the application. Then we go to the directory of the application and check the settings, fix anything there, or customize it. For example, change any username or password, etc., depending on the application. And the last step is to build the application with DS make. It updated the scripts of this application. You see that there are some new changes, latest changes coming from the repository. And then we run this init. It is already initialized. There exists already some this application. Then we go to the directory of the application, var/ds MariaDB. We check the settings. Again, we can set SMTP server, SMTP domain for notification emails. And nothing else to change. We just build it. For MariaDB application, again, when we build it again, it is like rebuild. And it reuses the data that are already there. The data are in this directory, and the configuration are saved in this directory. So when we build it again, then it will reuse the same data and configurations that it already has. Just a make to build it. Okay, the package manager, apt apt, tries to get some packages from the repository, and it fails. This happens time after time with Docker containers because the Docker caches images, and sometimes the cache is old, and also the configuration of the apt inside this cache image is a bit old, and when it tries to get a certain version of application, it fails because it already is replaced by newer versions in repository, and it doesn't exist. We can fix this by by updating the applications, the Docker images. For example, we have we have the Ubuntu image here. Let's try to update it to get the latest version. And now we can try to rebuild the container. The image is built. Now it will start the container and make the necessary configurations. Is done. Now the last step is to install the Nextcloud application itself. Again, we follow almost the same steps. DS pull Nextcloud. This time, this application was not installed on the Flask server, so it pulled the repository from GitLab. Then we initialize the application. This is the init. The name of the application that will be initialized, Nextcloud, and then the directory where we want to initialize it. And we will name the directory after the domain name of the application, and the domain name we will call it cloud.flask.org. Now it tells us that it is initialized on this directory. We go to this directory. There is only settings and apps.txt. Let's check settings first. Image. Nextcloud container. We'll name the container after the domain. And the domain is cloud.flask.org. And we also need an email address for getting Let's Encrypt SSL certificates. I will give my own address. It doesn't matter. Any address will do. And then it will install automatically an admin user. And we need to give the username, password, and email address of the admin user. Admin user, let's call it for the time being, admin pass. Get some random password. Then add me email. I will give my email address. Or let's give the email address of Flask. Hopefully there is a better email address. And admin user, let's call it And now we'll tell the details of the database. And we need to comment this line in order to use an external database. Otherwise, it will not use an external database, we'll use it internally. The host and port doesn't matter, they can stay the same. For the name of the database, I usually name it after the domain in order to know which database belongs to which application. Also, database user can be anything, but let's name it. The password actually doesn't matter because nobody will ever need to use it, so we can get another random password. Then SMTP server and SMTP domain. This is if we want the server to send periodically notification emails. As SMTP server for Flask, we use smtp.fs.al. And the for the domain, we usually use notify.flask.org. It is also possible to use Redis. Application, external Redis application to make it more efficient, but this time we are not doing it. And so we fixed settings.sh. Let's have a look at the list of apps. These are the Nextcloud applications, because Nextcloud is modular, it has lots of applications. And this is the list of applications that will be installed automatically. I don't know what each of these applications application does, but somehow they might be useful. If we have a better idea, then we can add some other applications to the list or remove some that we don't want. So let's start the building the application, the container. PS make. image is built already. Now it will create a container and make the necessary installations and configurations inside it. And it also automatically gets a SSL certificate from Let's Encrypt. Now, this is the list of Nextcloud applications that it is being installed, the apps. Let's try to check it. We get a login screen. Let's remind again what are the username and password of admin. They are stored on settings. So we have NC admin as username and have this one as password. And we are inside Nextcloud application. There are also desktop applications and Android and iPhone applications for Nextcloud, so that you can synchronize the files. So from the desktop, you can synchronize the files to the server, and then from the application on the server, we can you can get them to Android or to the smartphone. This is the menu for the admin. Let's go to the server. One open page is the open administration. We see that the version that we have installed of the Nextcloud is 19.0.2. And it is up to date. Let's go to the apps. This is the list of applications. We can disable some of them. We can enable some others. These are notifications. It is recommending this app, social. We can try to install it another time. And here are the apps that are already installed. So here we can check the file, the list of files. Let's try to upload something. Upload file. Okay, let's upload this test. Where is it? It is here. It is a C++ program. And we can share it. We can comment, rename, etc. Let's see the details. So the file uploading and file sharing is the most or the best known function or application of Nextcloud, but it also has other apps, for example, for photos. It appears that we can organize them into albums, and we can share albums and also tag the photos and set locations from there. And there are also other apps like calendar, audio player, quick note, soundtrack, music, deck, crossfan, and note. So most of them seem interesting application.
All right. Thank you very much for that, Dasha. I don't know if we have any questions from the audience. In the meanwhile, can you tell me what deal with these Docker scripts? Who writes them, and where can we find them? And are there different versions of those, or you know what are the best options to go and get them?
Okay, thanks, Aaron, for the question. Docker scripts are some scripts that I have developed for my purposes to help myself, but they can be also used by other people. Let me share the link to the Docker scripts. They are on GitLab. Mm-hmm. Now we installed Nextcloud. Since there is still time until the next presentation, let me share my screen with you, and we can continue with installing Git as well. Git is a web interface for Git. It is similar to GitHub. I don't have the possibility to share my screen. Can you make me present or something?
Yeah, let me do that. Okay, go ahead.
So, first of all, while we are at Nextcloud, I forgot to mention in the presentation something about the management of the Nextcloud with DockerScript. One of the things is the backup. We can do a backup with the command DC. Now, if I press tab, then I get some options, and backup is one of them. So this is one of the commands that is recognized by DockerScript for this application, for Nextcloud. So if I press DS, backup, then it will make a backup of the application.
All right. Various people can add to these scripts and perhaps improve them all the time and integrate different applications.
You are right. So there are scripts for each application. There are some common scripts that are used on all the applications, but for each different application, there are some specific scripts. For example, for Nextcloud, the backup procedure is different than another application, for example, Moodle. So the script has to be different, and we write another script. I have written another script for Nextcloud. Now we have this backup file, and if we want to restore it, there is a command ds restore, and I give the file name. I'm not doing it now, but that is the idea. And for example, we see among the commands there is also this occ command. This is a specific command for Nextcloud. If I add DC OCC, it will give the options for other subcommands and their options. And usually it seems that they are organized according to the modules. For example, for the user module, there are these commands. For some other modules, for example, for the talk. So I believe that we can manage Nextcloud completely from command line with this command, OCC. Maybe there is something that can be done only from the web interface, but in general, we can do everything from this, from the command line. For example, DC, OCC, let's try, for example, user list. And there are two users currently. It is the admin user and another user that has been logged in with Google login. Let's try, for example, user info. So it needs to get a username. For example, user info. And it gives the details for this user. We can also add users, make admins, and so on. This far for Nextcloud. Now we can also install Git. First of all, we get the scripts. DS pool. They are already installed or downloaded because it just clones the repo from GitLab. These are the scripts for Git. And then we need to install to initialize a directory. Just ds init Git. And it has created this directory, git.flask.org. So the name of the directory can be anything, but I name it according to the domain name so that I don't mix the applications with each other, because there can be several Git applications or several Nextcloud applications installed on the same server. And then the next step is to check the settings. And possibly, optionally, make any configuration changes. For example, I can name the container according to the domain as well, container git.flask.org. Also, the image. These are not so important, but we can do it. And then this is important, the domain, flask.org. Save it. Since we are getting a SSL certificate, it requires an email. This email is just to notify you if the domain is approaching the expiration time. Because let's end it. SSL certificates have a validity for 90 days, and if you don't renew in this time, then they expire. And this email is to notify you if the domain is approaching expiration of it has already expired. And then if we want to send the notifications from the server, which is important in the case of Git, we also have to specify the settings for SMTP server. And SMTP domain, we usually use notify.flask.org for the applications that are installed on the Flask server. This is wrong. And these are also optional. Application name, admin user, this should be changed. For example, and database. We also want to use an external database, so we are commenting out these sections, these settings, and also name the database according to the domain. Database password doesn't matter. It can be anything because we will never use it. It is just an internal password that the application will use to access the data in the database. And the last step is actually this is saved in the cache, so the image has already been built, and Docker saves images in the cache, so it didn't need to build the image this time. It just starts a container and then makes the necessary configurations. But before doing that, it also gets an SSL certificate from Let's Encrypt, and certificate is okay, I think. Now it is done. Let me share the browser and try to access this Git application that we just installed. Let's try to log in as admin. The name is Flask. And we are in as admin. We can check the settings and also go to site administration. It is similar to GitHub, but not so complicated, because GitHub has added more things lately. It is like a GitHub of 2 years ago, for example. Okay, and that's my presentation. If there is any question.
Okay, thank you very much, Dasha, for this extra presentation on GitEas, which is the Git web interface. And thank you also for the Nextcloud and the Docker script project that you're working on. I think it's very exciting. It should be promoted more and to be adopted by more people worldwide. I already saw, I think, 20 projects that you had put the scripts for, and we hope to see by the next edition to see many more covered. So I hope other people will contribute as well. Thank you very much once again.
Okay, thanks, Alan.
And pleasure to have you. Okay, and next session will start at 1:30. And it's another workshop called Introduction to Wikidata with Lucy Amy Kafi, I think, if I pronounce the name correct, although Lucy will tell us during Q&A how to pronounce her name correctly. So if you don't know, Wikidata is the structured data project under Wikimedia Commons, something that at Flask we do quite a bit. And I'm sure she is very experienced. So if you have questions, please, you know, something that's, this is an introductory presentation, but if you want to get more in-depth answers from Lucy, feel free to do. See you at 1:30 for the next presentation.